Believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed, number 7, number 8, 81. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ.
The gospel reading is Luke chapter 24, beginning with the 13th verse. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him." but we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that he had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 of their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It is an honor to be here in the church where my parents met and were married, standing in the pulpit that my father and grandfather have preached from, although I am doing things a little bit differently, doing it my way by standing on a box this morning. So will you pray with me? Oh God, open our eyes, open our hearts, and open our arms to welcome all in your name. Amen. So a couple of years ago, I was out grocery shopping, and as I went to go into the store, a man came out, saw me, and started running towards me, very excited. I had no idea who this person was, but he seemed to recognize me, and so I decided to do the polite thing and pretend to recognize him too. And so I called back, "Oh, hi, how are you?" And then he got about 5 feet from me, and he stopped and he said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you were someone else." And so then I had to pretend not to have been pretending to recognize him and just get out of there. Now, I'm sure we've all had moments of failing to recognize someone we know or thinking we recognize someone we don't know. Some of you might have known my little brother Noah when he was in high school at Myers Park. At the time, he had that swoopy hair and he was regularly mistaken for Justin Bieber. People were always disappointed to learn that he was not, in fact, the Biebs. But what happens on the road to Emmaus seems like a little more than a case of mistaken identity. The two men who were walking along, they knew Jesus, and they knew Scripture, and here was Jesus interpreting Scripture about himself, and they still don't get it. We read, their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Kept by what? Was God clouding their vision to make a point? Did the trauma of Jesus' death make them doubt what they saw? Was the sun in their eyes? Or was something else at work? Now, the emotional undercurrent of this passage is one of confusion and disappointment. Things had not turned out at all the way the disciples wanted. They weren't even sure whether to believe this story they were hearing from the women who went to the tomb. They were still grieving Jesus' death and all that the loss represented. And they utter this plaintive phrase, "We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Now, hope is a tricky thing. It can keep us pressing forward and sustain us through dark times, but like many good things, it can be distorted. When that happens, hope becomes expectation or assumption. If you expect or assume that something will go in a certain way, you will be disappointed and perhaps even angry when it doesn't. Had the disciples really hoped or had they expected or assumed? Now, there were many ideas about what the Messiah would be like in their day. Many people were expecting a conquering king who would overthrow the Roman Empire and restore the kingdom of Israel. And Jesus talked a lot about a kingdom, but it was not the one the disciples were expecting. In a way, Jesus is a disappointing Messiah. He answers questions with stories and riddles and more questions. He hangs out with all the wrong people. And in the end, he dies after just 3 years of public teaching. And so again and again in the Gospels, the disciples miss Jesus' point. Even when Jesus performs miracles or demonstrates how Scripture is being fulfilled right then and there, very few people understand what he's saying. Now today we like to laugh and shake our heads at the hapless disciples. Oh, how could they have so thoroughly misunderstood Jesus? If we had lived back then, surely we would have gotten it. We would have recognized him. But we fail to recognize Jesus every day, and we have the benefit of 2,000 years of hindsight. We domesticate God, and we impose our worldview on Jesus until he agrees with and ordains our every thought, word, and action. If your Jesus shares your political views, or your worship style preference, or your language, or the color of your skin, you may have made God in your own image. Are we looking for the Christ we want to find? Or are we willing to be found by the true Christ? As I was working on this sermon, I talked to my fiance Colin about this, and he said that the story of the walk to Emmaus has always been revolutionary to him. In it, he sees the people putting their hope in Christ as an idol rather than in following his path. I had to think about that, and I came across this image by the theologian Paul Tillich. He compares faith to a window. Now, when you look out a window over a beautiful view, you don't focus on that pane of glass. The pane of glass lets you see what is beyond it. Faith is a window. Prayer is a window. The Bible is a window. These things help us to see and to know and to follow God. Writer Kate Braestrup says that too often that which should reveal becomes opaque. Sometimes we stop at that pane of glass and we fail to look beyond it. Braestrup says the quickest way to ruin a window is to worship it, to make the word, the book, the human being into an idol, to abandon the view and focus on the glass. And this is what the disciples have done with their idea of Jesus. Their assumptions and expectations about how God would be revealed to them have ossified and become an idol of their own making. As they walk and talk, Jesus is trying to pull back the shades to let them see the kingdom vista beyond and through the scriptures they know so well, but they just can't see it. They've allowed their interpretation of scripture and their preconceived notions about the Messiah to become their gods. And this keeps them from recognizing God incarnate walking right beside them. Even though the Bible is a precious revelation of God's truth, it too can become an idol. It can become that opaque window that obscures the view it wants to offer. In John chapter 5, Jesus addresses this, and in The Message by Eugene Peterson, I love the way he renders Jesus' words. He says, "You have your heads in your Bibles constantly because you think you'll find eternal life there, but you miss the forest for the trees. These scriptures are all about me. And here I am, standing right in front of you, and you aren't willing to receive from me the life you say you want." The Bible is our holy book. In it we find everything necessary for salvation. But it's not a manual or a how-to guide. It's not even an object of faith. It reveals our faith. It is, as Martin Luther said, the cradle that holds Christ. We are called to hear and to welcome the Word made flesh, Jesus, into our lives. Now, there's a moment in the Emmaus story when Jesus acts like he's going to go on ahead when the disciples reach their destination. But the two men stop him and they say, "No, stay with us." They still don't know who he is, but they feel compelled to welcome him in. Now this reminds me of Matthew 25, the story that Jesus tells about how every time we give food to the hungry or drink to the thirsty, welcome to the stranger, care to the sick, clothing to the naked, and company to the imprisoned, we do these things to him. Jesus consistently identifies himself with the most vulnerable in society, and he doesn't just go to serve them. We find Jesus in them. If we were to look for Jesus today, we would see him most clearly at the margins of society, in the LGBTQ community, in communities of color, among persecuted Muslims, among refugees and immigrants, in the homeless and the poor, among sex workers and addicts, and everyone the dominant culture treats as disposable or undesirable. You may know that our country is in the midst of a heroin epidemic. I've learned a lot about it recently through my fiance. He and some friends have started a syringe exchange in Winston-Salem. They operate on the principle of harm reduction. So they give out clean needles, they dispose of used ones safely, they distribute life-saving overdose reversal drugs and offer treatment referrals and education about disease prevention. Now, to some people, this sounds like enabling. I know it did to me when I first heard about it. But in just a few months of operating, they've referred 4 people to drug treatment programs, and at last count, this work had resulted in 28 overdose reversals. That's 28 people who otherwise may have died before having a chance at recovery. Now, many people in our community have reacted with fear or at least concern over the syringe exchange, but we find that often these fears are not based on reality, but on negative stereotypes of drug addicts. We tend to treat addicts like monsters, but they are vulnerable people in need. I once went out on a delivery for the exchange. They operate on site and mobile. And my fiance reminded me that the most important thing I would do that day was not to deliver supplies or to take needles to be disposed of. It would be to treat this person with compassion. He said I might be the only person that he would interact with that day who wasn't trying to take advantage of him or for whom he needs to put on an act. And I have my own fears and prejudices, so as I went to the door, I imagined Jesus saying, "I was a drug user and you gave me a clean syringe." And I remember that by extending hospitality to this man and his brokenness, I might be welcoming Jesus himself. At Emmaus, the disciples invite Jesus in without knowing that it's him. They make him a guest at their table, but Jesus becomes the host. When Jesus goes through the motions of taking, blessing, breaking, and giving, the disciples' eyes are opened. They've seen this before, at the feeding of the 5,000 and at the Last Supper. And although they didn't realize it at the time, they saw it too on the cross, when Jesus himself was taken and broken and given up for us. Even in the resurrection, Jesus bears the wounds of the cross. In the breaking of the bread and in the breaking of his body, God meets us in the fullness of our humanity so that we might receive the fullness of his grace. There is no depth of human suffering to which God has not already descended for our sake. In this way, he comes to know us and be known by us in a profound and intimate way. The centurion at the cross knew Jesus in his suffering and dying. Thomas the doubter knew Jesus by the mark where the nails had been. And the men at Emmaus knew him in the breaking of the bread. Here, Jesus isn't just opening the blinds, he is tearing off the roof. What was broken was not just bread in Jesus' body, it was the notions about the Messiah that were shattered and broken open so that the disciples could finally see with true hope through the opaque window of their expectations. And still today, God breaks our hearts of stone so that we can receive and share Jesus' love and grace. Frederick Buechner says, "I believe that although the two disciples did not recognize Jesus on the road to Emmaus, Jesus recognized them. I believe that whether we recognize him or not, or believe in him or not, or even know his name, again and again, he comes and walks a little way with us along whatever road we're following. We may feel completely lost. We may be completely lost, but Jesus walks with us. We are already found. It's like when you're looking for your keys and you realize they've been in your hand the whole time. We are already and always held in God's hand. We can rest in the assurance that even when we don't see or recognize Jesus, he is with us, and we are not alone. Kate Braestrup writes, maybe the point isn't to know precisely where or how to find God. Maybe you just need to know how to answer when God at last finds you. Samuel wasn't looking for God when God found him in the temple and called to him in the night. Mary wasn't looking for God when the angel Gabriel came to her with unbelievable news. But they knew how to answer when God found them. And they tell us how, with open eyes, open hearts, and the same words that Jesus calls out to us again and again until at last we recognize him and we too answer, "Here I am." Amen.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus. Hey, thank you for watching. And we hope you got something out of that. If you have any feedback for us, any response that was helpful to you, we would love to hear that. Please let us know. And everything that we put out is free, and we want it to be that way. But if you're able and feel led to support the mission of our church or the cost of providing this online content, here's how to do so.